afternoon, everyone. Thank you all so much for coming out today on this beautiful day, and I'm hopeful that when you leave in an hour and a half, and walk home and look up or look down or look straight ahead, that what you see out there will be even more beautiful than it was when you came in. My name is Denny May, and I'm a member of the Tree Commission of Takoma Park. We are one of the co-sponsors of the event today, but first I would like to thank your city government of Takoma Park for their generous financial support for today's program, as well as their support logistically with the events crew here and the television people as well. But especially in city government, Jesse Carpenter and Daryl Braithwaite in Public Works. Jesse, the city clerk, and Daryl Braithwaite in Public Works have been very helpful for this. Also, just to clear all this up at the beginning, the other sponsors are the members of Natural Takoma, which include the Tree Commission, Friends of Sligo Creek, Historic Takoma, the Takoma Horticultural Club, and the City of Takoma Park Committee on the Environment. So I would like to just start off with a short, somewhat embarrassing story, and then we'll get to why what you're here for. My wife, Betsy Taylor, is sitting in the back there, and for our lifetime, really, for our adult lifetime, we have been environmentalists and have spent a lot of our time, both professionally and our free time, doing environmental stuff, especially Betsy. But mostly big picture stuff like, climate change, nuclear power, consumption and the environment, stuff like that. And so we thought we were, pretty good environmentalists. And then about 5 or 6 years ago, this is the embarrassing part, we live on Willow Avenue a couple blocks away, somebody gave us some milkweed seeds. So we planted them. Neither of us knew very much about them. We were trying to plant things in the front yard that looked pretty. So we planted these seeds and they grew really well. And all of a sudden one day, they blossomed. And so there were these tall plants with these beautiful orange blossoms. And we were so excited because it made the front yard look pretty, which is what we kind of had in mind. And then we came out a day or two later to discover that these beautiful plants had been eaten all the way down to about that far from the ground. Everything was gone. On those, there were stalks, just short stalks left. And hanging on the stalks were a series of very plump, obese caterpillars. Very pretty, and stuffed because they had just... And so our reaction at that time, because we didn't know better, was, oh, man, that's it for those plants. We're not going to plant those if the insects are just going to eat them. But then, fortunately, one or the other of us heard Doug Tallamy on the radio. Then we got his book and read that. And literally, I think it's fair to say that our lives were changed. It was reading his book and learning about our yards and what was going on in the ecosystem of our yards was like what we felt when we read Michael Pollan and learned about food. And we're so lucky to have Doug with us today. Doug is a very busy man. He spoke to a full house last night down at the U.S. Botanical Garden. He speaks all around the country 100 times this year so far. Doug is a professor at the University of Delaware. He is a professor of entomology and wildlife ecology. He's probably best known for his book, Bringing Nature Home. He also has another book with him today that that is more recent. And after he talks and answers questions today, he will go out into the lobby and be glad to sign books for anyone who would like to get one or have yours signed. So it's with great pleasure that I introduce Doug Tallamy. Please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you very much, Denny. Can everybody hear me? Yes? You'd be surprised, Denny. That's That's a story I hear a lot. I'll get an email or somebody will call me up. It's usually, wow. They'll call me up and say, I planted milkweed for the monarchs, but worms got on it, so I squished them. You know, I gave a, it's always great to see a full house, a nice audience, particularly on a really nice day. I took four students to an event called Mothapalooza, which is a different story, but in southern Ohio. I did that this summer, and on the way, I had to stop in Columbus to give a talk to the Grange Audubon. And three of the students wanted to go to the motel, but one student said, well, I'll come with you to this talk. And we're driving there. We walk in. It's a room full of people. And he said, is this a conference? And I said, no, it's just me. And he said, these people are here just to hear you? I said, I still haven't figured that out. Yeah. Okay, we're going to talk broadly about bringing nature home. You can call it restoring nature's relationships, creating living landscapes, 50 shades of green, whatever you want to call it. But we're going to start by asking what this bird is. Can we lower the lights just a little bit more? Lower the lights just a little bit more so you can, this jumps out at you. Yeah, this is the resplendent quetzal. There we go. Ah. This is an endangered species in the forests of Central America, and it's endangered for one primary reason. It has a very specialized diet. If you don't have fruits of the wild avocado tree, you don't have quetzals. As a matter of fact, you don't have any of the trogons if you know your South American birds. Well, we've cut down most of the avocado trees, and that's why the birds are in trouble. But we figured out we want these birds in our future, so we're planting wild avocado trees, and that's what these folks are doing right here. Turns out that they grow pretty quickly. They reach the age at which they make their little fruits in not too many years, and it's starting to look better for the future of that beautiful bird. But that same conservation scenario is repeated time and time again in the tropics. If you want to save the jaguar, you have to have particular species of palm trees. Why palm trees? Because the species that are important make palm nuts. Not all palm trees make coconuts. They make these little palm nuts, and that happens to be the favorite food of peccaries, which is the favorite food of jaguars. So you're talking about specialization in the natural world, particularly focused on food webs, as being the rule, not the exception. And it always starts with plants. Now again, a lot of people think all that specialization occurs in the tropical areas of the world because there is so much specialization down there. But we also have a lot of specialization up here in the temperate zone, and some of the most specialized relationships that have ever evolved on this planet occur right in our yards. This is one of them. This is the bola spider. It's a female hanging from a river birch leaf in my yard. And it's obvious why she's called the bola spider. She doesn't spin a web. She just drops one strand of silk and puts a sticky glob of glue on the end there. Now, she doesn't throw it around her head like a bola. But she does, it looks like she's fishing with it. She lowers it and raises it and lowers it real slowly. And the first time I watched her do that, I told her, you're not going to catch anything. But can you imagine something flying into that, that one single glob of glue by accident? And also, that's the way I used to fish, and I didn't catch anything. So. But about 15 seconds later, a moth flew in, got stuck on the little glob of glue. She reeled it in and actually laid her eggs on it. And what I didn't know at the time is that that was not an accident. She was releasing the sex pheromone of this particular species of moth. She'd mimicked the sex pheromone. So this guy's a male. He thought she was a female. She is, but the wrong species. And that's the end of him. And it turns out that every species of bola spider in the world mimics the sex pheromone of one species of moth. Highly specialized relationship. So you can have bola spiders in your yard if you have the plant that supports the larval development of the moth that your bola spider is mimicking the sex pheromone of. Phlox divaricata, a very common spring ephemeral in our gardens, spreads readily from seed, but only if it's pollinated. I've watched native bees land on these flowers. It's a very tiny corolla there, and these bees cannot get their tongues into that corolla. So who is pollinating our phlox? Well, if you watch your phlox carefully, you'll see it's day-flying sphinx moths. Things like the hummingbird sphinx or the snowberry clearwing, they have very long tongues, and they can sink them straight into that corolla. And when they pull them out, they are covered with pollen, and they move to the next flower. Very efficient pollinators of phlox. So you can get your phlox pollinated, make lots of phlox seed if you have adult snowberry clearwings. And you can have adult snowberry clearings if you have larval snowberry clearings. And you can have larval snowberry clearings if you have coral honeysuckle. That is its native host plant. Even animals we don't think of as having specialized relationships with plants often do, at least at one part of their life cycle. And I'm going to use the Carolina chickadee as an example. That, of course, is the chickadee we have down here in the D.C. area. And a lot of people think that chickadees are seed eaters because they are. All winter long, they're eating seed, one of the most common birds that are feeders. But when it comes time to make more chickadees, when it comes time to reproduce, they're not feeding the baby seed. They are feeding them caterpillars. And if they're in a rich environment, they feed them almost exclusively on caterpillars. And it turns out that they are not alone. Most birds rear their young in insects, and most of those insects are caterpillars, even though there's a lot of other insects out there, or adult caterpillars. That's a moth. So let's ask the question, why caterpillars? What is special about caterpillars? Well, it could be because they're beautiful. We got a lot of beautiful caterpillars out there, like the Pandora sphinx, the Coletta silk moth, spiny rose caterpillar, the black swallowtail, common black swallowtail, it's gorgeous. The hieroglyphic moth, spun glass caterpillar, that's my favorite. Could be because they have cool names, like the green marvel, the once charred punky, the confused wood grain, cynical ground cat, the neighbor, the Donald. Have you noticed the Donalds everywhere these days? Actually, I don't think it's because they have cool names or they're pretty. There's some very practical reasons. A lot of caterpillars are soft, and those are the ones that are being eaten primarily. And that means you can stuff them down the throat of your baby without fear of injuring the esophagus. Very important. They're also really nutritious. They're high in protein, they're high in lipids, fats, and they're the best source of carotenoids during the spring when the birds are reproducing. Now, later on in the year, berries make a lot of carotenoids, and the birds eat those. But during the spring, there aren't any berries. They haven't made the berries yet. Well, what's a carotenoid, and why does it matter? That's a carotenoid. These are compounds made by plants, only by plants. Vertebrates don't make them. So chickadees don't make them. We don't make them. And there's a number of them that are considered essential for healthy diets. And that's why my wife, Cindy, tells me I have to eat my carrots to get my beta carotene, my tomatoes to get my lycopene, my whatever that is to get my lutein. She makes sure I eat all of that. Why? Well, these guys are antioxidants. They run around our body. They don't repair damaged DNA, but they protect it from being oxidized. They stimulate the immune system, so we're just generally healthier if we've got a lot of carotenoids. They improve color vision. When your mother said, eat your carrots and you will see better, she was right. She didn't know she was right, but turns out she was right. Improve sperm vitality. Who doesn't need that? Improve sexual attractiveness. Now we're talking about the birds taking the pigments from the carotenoids and putting them in their feathers, particularly the males. So this is a male vermilion flycatcher. He's red because he has loaded his feathers with carotenoid pigments. And then, of course, he's more attractive to the ladies. Well, chickadees aren't making their own carotenoids, and they're not eating plants when they're reproducing, so they've got to get their carotenoids from something that does eat plants. And yes, that something is insects, but here's the important point. Caterpillars produce twice as many carotenoids as other types of insects. We don't know why, but that seems to be the story. So it apparently caterpillars are much closer to essential components of bird diets than optional ones. And that means if you're in an area that doesn't have enough caterpillars when you're trying to reproduce, you're not going to be able to reproduce successfully. So if we're talking about chickadees, now we have to know how many caterpillars it takes to make a clutch of chickadees. And the answer is it takes a lot. And it was these chickadees that told me that. I put a little chickadee box up in my yard, low enough so I could set my camera up and take pictures of what they were bringing back to the nest. And that's when I learned they were bringing back caterpillars. I also learned they were bringing them back very quickly. The male and the female are cooperating when they're foraging, feeding the young, and they can bring a caterpillar back to the nest once every 3 minutes. In one 27-minute period, they brought back 30 caterpillars. How do they do that? By bringing back more than one at a time. sometimes a whole bunch. They're doing this all day long, 6 a.m. to 8 p.m., working very hard. Now, the next question is, how many species of caterpillars are they bringing back? Chickadees and other birds don't forage very far from the nest. They're trying to do it in the most energy-efficient way. So chickadees forage about 50 meters from the nest. So if you want chickadees to breed in your yard, don't think they're going to fly 5 miles down the road to the nearest woodlot. You have to have what they need within that 50-meter radius. Well, in a three-hour period, they brought back 17 species of caterpillars. So I had 17 species within the 50-meter radius. Why is that important? That is important because if I had one or two species of caterpillars, and it happened to be a bad year for them, like this spring. This is a terrible spring for caterpillars, at least at my house. It was too cold and too wet. Well, then there wouldn't be enough caterpillars for the chickadees to be able to successfully reproduce. And they don't live very long, you know, 3 years on average. They have to reproduce every year. If I have 17 species or 34 species or 134 species in that little space, then there will always be some combination of species that no matter what the weather will be common enough so that the chickadees will be able to reproduce. So this is an example of diversity creating stability in this food web, or diversity creating stability in your ecosystem. You've heard that diversity is a good thing. This is why. It stabilizes these interactions, and no matter what the weather is, the chickadee gets to breed successfully every year. Well, there was a guy by the name of Brewer in 1961 who decided he wanted to count all the caterpillars that Carolina chickadees bring back to their young every day. And I don't know why he wanted to do that, but he did it. In fact, it was between 390 and 570, depending on the number of chicks in the nest. And they're doing that for 16 days until the chicks fledge. After they fledge, the parents feed the chicks caterpillars another 30 days outside of the nest, but nobody can follow them at that point, so we don't know how many caterpillars that is. But just to the point where they fledge, that's between 6,000 and 9,000 caterpillars required to make one clutch of chickadees. And these are tiny birds, 1/3 of an ounce. That's 4 pennies. What if we wanted to make a red-bellied woodpecker? Weighs 8 times more than a chickadee. How many caterpillars does that take? And of course, we don't want just chickadees and red-bellied woodpeckers in our neighborhoods. We want a variety of birds. We'd love to have scarlet tanagers. We certainly want our titmice and our blue jays and bluebirds and tree swallows and common yellow throats and indigo bunnings and towhees and yellow warblers and wood thrushes and wrens and our cardinals and our hummingbirds. These are all birds we expect to be in our neighborhoods. But can you imagine? Now, I'm not talking about one pair. I'm talking about breeding populations of these birds. How many caterpillars does it take to do that? An enormous number. And you're probably thinking, well, we don't need any caterpillars for the hummingbird there because it eats sugar water. It does like sugar water. But 80 to 90% of a hummingbird's diet is insects and spiders. And spiders, of course, needed insects to become spiders. Then they go for the sugar water. So you can put up your hummingbird feeder, and that's great. They appreciate that. But if you don't have the plants that make the insects that the hummingbirds need to become hummingbirds, you're not going to have a hummingbird. And that is true for 96% of the terrestrial birds in North America. These are the families of birds that rear their young directly or indirectly on insect protein. And by indirectly, I mean a lot of these will eat a fair number of spiders, but the spiders needed insects to become spiders. And this is news. This is news to a lot of people. Most people think birds eat seeds and berries because so many do eat seeds and berries. But even people who write landscape for birds books tell you how to put plants in your yard that make seeds and berries. Again, that's fine, but if we don't put the plants that make the insects in our yards as well, we won't have the birds to eat the seeds and the berries. So here's a generalization, but it's pretty close to true. No insects, no baby birds. All right, how do we do this? What types of landscapes are capable of producing the diversity and numbers of insects that we're talking about here? Well, to answer that question, we have to consider the most common type of specialized relationship that occurs all over the planet. And that's the relationship between the insects that eat plants and the plants themselves. So we're not talking about pollinators here. We're talking about things like this Polyphemus moth caterpillar and the oak leaf that it's eating. Remember, plants really don't want to be eaten. They want to capture the energy from the sun, use it for their own growth and reproduction. So they've loaded their tissues, particularly their leaves, with nasty-tasting chemicals, secondary metabolic compounds that make those tissues either bitter or downright toxic. And it's an amazingly effective defense that keeps most of the insects of the world from eating most of the plants of the world. And that's why we can look outside in the summertime and it's green. It's not because there's no insects out there that want to eat those plants. It's because most of the insects that are out there cannot eat those plants. They're too well defended. But we do know that insects eat plants. So how do they do that? How do they get around those chemical defenses? Well, this is where the specialization comes in. 90% of the insects that eat plants are what we call host plant specialists. They pick one or two lineages of plants that are sharing a common cocktail of chemical defenses, and they develop the adaptations necessary to circumvent those defenses. They develop the enzymes that store and excrete and detoxify those compounds, the behavioral adaptations that allow them to avoid eating them to begin with, the life history adaptations that minimize their exposure to these compounds. But it takes a long period of exposure to each of these plant lineages for all those adaptations to fall into place. It doesn't happen overnight. Let's use red cedar as an example. It, of course, is a conifer, which means it's very old. It has been in our landscapes for hundreds of millions of years, which means it was here ready to interact with the very first insects that came out onto our shores. So it's had plenty of time for all the insects to adapt to whatever defenses it has. But they haven't been able to do that. There's actually very few insects that can eat red cedar. And that's because it has found a really effective defense, a toxic monoterpene called beta-thujaplixin. But this is one insect that has adapted to it. This is the juniper hairstreak. It is a specialist on red cedar. And all that means is it can now eat beta-thujaplixin without dying. And that's the upside of specialization. The downside of specialization is that in developing all of the adaptations to get around beta-thujaplixin, it has not developed the adaptations to get around any other type of defense. So now that's all it can eat is red cedar. So it can't handle the tannins that are in oaks, it can't handle the cucurbitacins that are in cucurbits, or the nicotine in tobacco, or the cyanide in wild cherries, and so on. And that means if we don't landscape in a way that includes red cedar, we don't have that butterfly. The butterfly disappears because that's all it can eat. If you're going to eat red cedar, you might as well look like it. There's the caterpillar right there. This is Crypsis. This is another advantage of specializing. Now you can look so much like what you're eating that it's very hard for those birds to find you. They're pretty good. They can still find a lot of them, but hiding is a good strategy. In fact, everything that eats red cedar is highly cryptic. Here's the curved line angle right there, blending in. That's it up close. This is the juniper geometer blending in with the dead parts of red cedar. So fun with Crypsis, but you know, in today's world, specialization really has become a curse because we humans are modifying the landscape so much and we're not paying attention to these specialized relationships. We're bringing plants in from someplace else that our local insects have not been able to adapt to. They haven't had nearly enough time to adapt to it. So those plants are replacing the native plant communities that are supporting all of these specialized relationships. And nothing illustrates it better than our friend the monarch butterfly, which of course is a specialist on milkweeds. There you go, that's the common milkweed, beautiful bloom. But we have not been very nice to our milkweeds, particularly in our residential neighborhoods and our corporate landscapes. You know, we're not nice to our native plants in part because of a marketing issue. We call them weeds. This is milkweed, we've got New York ironweed, Joe Pye weed, pokeweed, they're all weeds, and you know we've got to kill weeds. If we change, and then we call invasive plants like ailanthus tree of heaven, or Polonia is princess tree. So we just need to change their names and we might be nicer to them. But. All right, we relied on, actually nobody was thinking about it, but it turned out that the edges of agricultural fields throughout most of North America did have these weeds, particularly milkweed, and that's what the monarch was relying on. Until recently, we've adopted a new culture of agriculture in which the edges of our fields are either bare because of Roundup Ready corn or we've got Roundup Ready corn and soybeans where we're spraying Roundup products and getting rid of all the weeds, or now they're manicured lawn, just like our front yards. So the monarch has declined 96% since 1976. And it is in trouble. Of course, we have the ability to bring it back, and people are working on that. We've got Monarch Watch, Monarch Way Stations, where we're putting in milkweeds all over the country because we want to save this beautiful butterfly. It may be the most iconic insect in the world, because not only is it a beautiful butterfly, it's got that fantastic migration. It migrates 3,000 miles down to Mexico. The reason we know it's in trouble is because they all go to one place in Mexico, and we can count them. The other insects that are out there, the other butterflies, aren't doing that, which means nobody's counting them. So they could be declining at the exact same rate that the monarch is, and we don't know it. And I suspect they are. It's not just the Lepidopter, the moths and butterflies that are host plant specialists. This is the elderberry beetle, only eats elderberry. The dogbane beetle only eats dogbane. Sumac flea beetle only eats sumac. This is a Korean bug that only eats ash. And you know, the emerald ash borer is on its way. If it takes out all of our ashes, we will lose this species. As a matter of fact, Dave Wagner has just finished a paper. He's up at the University of Connecticut looking at the specialist on ashes. It's 95 species that rely on ash, and they will all disappear if we lose our ashes. So that's the problem. It's the 90% of the insects that eat plants that are host plant specialists. They will not be in our ecosystems if we get rid of the plants on which they have specialized. There's good news. We can actually use our knowledge, our growing knowledge of what various food webs are comprised of, to rebuild them. And let's do it at home. Let's put those food webs right in our home if we understand the plants that are making the food that different things need. Let's use the white-eyed vireo as an example. And I'm going to use this as an example because that's the nest that my wife found in our yard a few years ago. They conveniently built it very low, so I could set up my camera again and take pictures of what the birds were bringing back to their babies. Then we could work backwards. We know a lot about what caterpillars eat. So if we know what the caterpillar is, we know what the host plant was, and then we know what plant is supporting reproduction in the white-eyed vireo. So let's do this for a little while. This is the blinded sphinx moth. It is a specialist on black cherry. Got a lot of black cherry in my yard, making blinded sphinx moths and many other things so the babies get to eat. This little guy is the chestnut caesura, and despite its common name, it's a specialist on native viburnum. Viburnum dentatum is common in our yard, and it's making chestnut caesura so the babies get to eat again. This guy is the drab prominent, a specialist on sycamore. Now, we didn't plant sycamore. Our yard was mowed for hay when we moved in 16 years ago. So we know most of the plants that are there, but we didn't plant sycamore. We did have a big wind about 13 years ago, blew in some sycamore seeds from who knows where, and one landed in my cold frame, and it germinated, and I'm not very fast at weeding things out. It is now 40 feet tall. But it's making drab prominence, and the babies get to eat again. So on and on we go. This is the eight-spotted forester moth, a specialist on native grapes. We have lots of them. The lunate zaley, another specialist on black cherry. This is the spicebush swallowtail caterpillar. There's its eye. It's supposed to scare the bird into thinking it's a tree snake. Didn't work. It's a specialist on spicebush or its close relative, sassafras. We have both of those. The tufted bird-dropping moth, another specialist on black cherry. So black cherry is emerging as a really important component of this bird's food web. But these guys are hungry. They need a lot more than that. So let's set some black walnut into the landscape. If we do that, we get the walnut sphinx, the gray-edged boma loca, the black blotched caesura, the bride. These are all specialists on black walnut. If we have native maples, we get Plagodes inchworms, the green-striped maple worm, the retarded dagger moth, and many others. Native elms. This is the American elm. Will give us the four-horned sphinx, double-toothed prominent, the interrupted dagger moth, and again, many others. Remember, 90% of the insects that you're going to rebuild this food web with won't be there if you don't have the plants that support them. So if you want the mustard sallow, you need witch hazel. If you want the hackberry emperor, we need hackberry. If you want Cuculio asteroides, you need native asters. The arcidura flower moth or the brown-hooded owlet need goldenrod. The hog sphinx, Pandora sphinx, Abbott sphinx all need Virginia creeper. The redbud leaf roller needs redbud. The gray furcula needs native willows. The turbulent phosphilla needs greenbrier. The orange tufted oneida, the spiny oak caterpillar, the two-spotted oak punky, the variable oak leaf caterpillar, the red-humped oak worm, the pink-striped oak worm, the pleasant dagger moth, the delightful dagger moth, the lesser oak dagger moth, the greater oak dagger moth, the afflicted dagger moth, the streaked dagger moth, the white blotched heterocampa, the oblique heterocampa, the red line panopoda, the laffer, and many, many more won't be there if we don't have oaks. Because it turns out that oaks are the most powerful plant we can put into our yards, or in our streets, by the way. By the way, you know where I took all these pictures? My front yard. We're not going to talk about backyard habitat, because that implies everything I'm talking about here is so ugly, we have to hide it in the backyard. It also cuts our conservation opportunity in half. What's wrong with the front yard? Put your oak tree in the front yard. It'll work. Why do we want all these insects? Why do we want all these caterpillars? We talk about birds. Yes, the birds want them. We like our birds. And that's a no-brainer. But it turns out they're essential components of most terrestrial food webs. So many other things depend on them, like those spiders. All spiders eat insects, or they eat other spiders that ate insects. And I know a lot of people don't like spiders, but look who does. It's the second most important component of bird food webs. Then we have these insect predators that are eating insect herbivores, and these themselves are important components of food webs. If we lost the herbivores, we would lose the predators. If we lost our insects, we would lose our frogs, our toads, all of our amphibians, because they all eat insects. So do our lizards, so do our bats, so do our rodents, believe it or not. You always think of rodents as seed eaters, and they do eat seeds when they can't find enough insects. But the reason they want insects is that it's just really good food. Pound for pound, there's twice as much protein in insect meat as there is in beef. And insects have organs in their abdomen called fat bodies that are loaded with lipids. And it allows these little guys to grow quickly and reproduce quickly. And if you're a mouse, that's what you want to do, because there's so many things that want to eat you. But it's the same reason that larger organisms are eating insects. They're just really good food. The skunk is digging up your yard to get this. The grubs that are in your yard. Possums eat a lot of insects. Raccoons eat a lot of insects. Even things we don't think of as insectivores eat a lot of insects. Like our friend the red fox here. 25% of its diet, full quarter of its diet, is insects. Black bear, 23% of its diet. Doesn't matter how big you are, you need insects. Even things that don't eat insects need insects. This is the sharp-shin hawk. It's a bird predator. You might think, well, at least I can have sharp-shin hawks in my neighborhood, even if I get rid of all the insects. But think about it. The birds this guy needs to eat needed insects to become birds. So he needs them indirectly. So does the garter snake. It's not eating insects directly. It's eating the frogs and toads that ate the insects. A world without insects is a world without biological diversity. And E.O. Wilson told us decades ago that a world without biological diversity is a world without humans. And that's why this is an important message to everybody. Doesn't matter where you live, whether you're in the heart of a city, whether you're in your rural area, you need biological diversity, because that is what is running the ecosystems that supports you. Well, what's happening to all those things that eat insects, all those species of insectivores? In most cases, we're not measuring it. We don't know what's happening. We do have some very general comments from the World Wildlife Fund that says we've lost 50% of the biodiversity of this planet in the last 40 years. That's not a happy number. But we do measure what's happening with birds. We have something called the State of the Birds Report, because there's so many people that love birds. They count them, they follow what's happening each year. And each year, a consortium of bird authorities gets together and makes a list of the birds that are in trouble. 2 years ago, 2014, they said 230 species of birds are at risk of extinction. 2 years ago. Well, I thought that was a terrible number, because when I was growing up, it was the California condor and the whooping crane, and that was all we talked about. 230 species 2 years ago. Just 2 years later, now it's 430 species of birds. That's a steep decline. 50% fewer birds today than just 40 years ago. So our birds are obviously not happy. By the way, 430 species, that's getting close to half the birds in North America at risk of extinction. Not good. What's the problem? The ecosystems that support these guys are not happy. And again, this is an important message to us, because those are the same ecosystems that support humans. What is wrong? What's wrong with those ecosystems? Why can't biodiversity be sustained in the parks and preserves that we have? Because we do have them. We've got them pretty much all over the place. There are a couple answers to that, but there's one simple one, and that is they're too small. Our parks and preserves are too small. When you take a large area like this and you shrink it down to a little habitat fragment, and this is an exaggeration, it doesn't have to be this small. You're taking large populations and shrinking them down to small populations. And that's the key. Small populations are highly vulnerable to local extinction. Why? Because all populations fluctuate. In good times they go up, bad times they go down. If you're a large population, even in your down cycle though, you can increase quickly when times get better. And that's the key, because if you're a tiny population, often in your down cycle, you hit zero. You blink out of your little habitat fragment and then you're gone. You can't increase when times get better. And if you don't recolonize, and our habitats are getting so fragmented, so far apart, it's more and more difficult to recolonize, you are permanently gone, and that is called local extinction. Don't think about extinction in terms of global extinction. If you don't have the same number of species in your yard that you had some period ago, does that affect your ecosystem function? That's what you want to think about, because ecosystems function locally, not globally. We've got studies all over the world, actually, and some of them are quite lengthy, 100 years in length, telling us the same thing, that our habitat fragments, the bit of nature we've left out there, is not large enough to sustain the nature we need it to sustain. And unfortunately, that includes our largest national parks. Well, not only have we fragmented the natural world, but we've also created a phenomenon that we now call invasive species. Let's just talk about invasive plants. 3,300 species of plants have been introduced to North America now that are aggressively displacing native plant communities. That's the definition of invasive. It's got to be non-native, and it's displacing native plant communities. So I've heard people say, oh, I've got invasive natives. No, you don't. You can have an aggressive native that might be duking it out with another native, like it has always done a natural interaction. But when a non-native plant is pushing out the natives, that is an unnatural interaction, and it causes problems. This is White Clay Creek State Park. It's a park I drive by on the way to work. One of those preserves is supposed to be maintaining the local biodiversity. Well, it turns out that plants, particularly from Asia, leaf out before plants from North America. So in March, in the spring, when things are starting to leaf out, that's a perfect time to look at your natural areas. Look at Rock Creek Park and all the other natural areas you have, and any green you see doesn't belong there. So that's what you're looking at here. This is March. All of the green you see in White Clay Creek State Park here are introduced plants primarily from Asia. Where'd they come from? Well, they're all our favorites. There's multiflora rose, oriental bittersweet, Japanese honeysuckle, bush honeysuckle, miscanthus, autumn olive, porcelain berry, privet, burning bush, ailanthus, Norway maple. These are all escapees from the horticultural trade, and that is what is now in our natural areas. About a third of the vegetation in our natural areas doesn't belong there and is not interacting with those insects that are creating the basis to all those food webs. Well, how bad is it? What happens when we allow non-native plants to take over the native plant communities? That's what we've been measuring formally in my lab for the last, I guess it's 12 years now. Several papers published on it. You can go to the journals, you can read them. I know you're not going to do that, but I'll make it easy for you. We always get the same answer. But how about if I tell you about my 12 by 12 experiment that you can do at home? You can get your local school kids to do, and you can measure this for yourself and decide whether or not there's an important impact here. This is what 12 feet by 12 feet looks like if you stake it out in your yard. And it illustrates several things. First of all, it illustrates that this is your opportunity to play God, because you get to determine how much life is going to exist in this space, because you determine what plants are going to be there. And that is what's determining what the life is going to be. So you can keep it as lawn, and you can get on your hands and knees on Wednesday and count all the biodiversity right in here. Won't take you that long. And then on Saturday, you can kill it all by mowing it. Or we can put a tree in that space. Here's a white oak that I planted 14 years before I took this picture from an acorn. And by the way, that illustrates two things. First of all, that oaks grow. Well, if you listen to a lot of landscapers, they will tell you, do not plant an oak because you won't live long enough to enjoy it. I'm enjoying it. I'm still alive. It's about 25 feet tall. And if your oak has to be 300 years old before you enjoy it, then they're right, but it doesn't. It doesn't. The other thing it illustrates is that it was free, an acorn. You can go out right now and collect acorns, and you can plant them, and you will get a tree like that if you protect them from the deer. So you don't have to buy a $3,000 oak that is so root-pruned because it needs to be transplanted, that it's going to sit there for a decade trying to rebuild those roots without growing at all. You don't have to do that. Just plant your acorn, and you will get a tree that's as big as that giant one you just paid a lot of money for. They catch up and actually pass them because they're much healthier. They've got a giant root system. All right, let's do our 12 by 12 experiment. Let's walk around the perimeter of that tree and count the caterpillars on those branches. Now, we're not going to climb step ladders, so we're not going to fall off and break any bones. We're just going to walk around the perimeter and count the caterpillars, and we're going to do it July 25th of 2014. We're going to find 410 caterpillars from 19 different species on that tree, and then we're going to stand back and take that picture so that I can ask you, how many of those caterpillars do you see? How much of the caterpillar damage do you see? You don't see anything. You don't see any caterpillars or the damage. And this is the distance at which we view our trees, or farther away. But if I knocked on your door and said, you've got 410 caterpillars on your oak tree, call the spray man, kill them, you got to save the oak. This is a natural interaction. The oak is passing on part of the energy it's sequestered from the sun to the caterpillars, which soon will be in the belly of a bird. You have living things in your yard because the oak is willing to do that. So you don't have to worry about them killing the tree. Oaks are always supporting numbers like that, completely natural. Let's go to our black cherry, about the same size, 12 by 12, count the caterpillars, 239 caterpillars from 14 different species. Okay, let's go to my neighbor's house now. My neighbor moved in the same month that we did. He made different plant choices. He really liked calorie pear, which you might know it as Bradford pear. So he planted 32 of them. So the first thing we have to decide is which one we're going to measure. Actually, the first thing we have to decide is whether he's home or not. We can walk around, count the caterpillars on we're going to choose this one. I did find a caterpillar. I found one inchworm from one species. Then I went to his burning bush. By the way, I spend the rest of the year pulling out calorie pear and burning bush from my yard. These are highly invasive plants that we still use heavily in ornamental landscaping. 12 by 12 section, count the caterpillars on burning bush. I found four caterpillars from one species, four little leaf skeletonizers, too small to be part of a local food web. Well, what if that was a fluke? What if I happened to pick a really productive white oak and really productive black cherry and really unproductive burning bush and calorie pear? Let's do it again the next day on July 26th. Different plants, same species. And this is called replication in an experiment. You'd actually want to do this a number of times. But we get different numbers, but the same pattern. So 233 caterpillars and 15 species on the white oak, 53 in the black cherry, 2 in the burning bush, 1 on the calorie pear. And that's what you'd want to do. You'd want to repeat it time and time again. You can do it 1,000 times, and that's the pattern you would see. We've got a number of genera of native plants that are really, really productive, producing almost all the food. These plants from Asia can't do it because they haven't been here long enough to establish the specialized relationships required for all these insects to be able to adapt to them. It doesn't make them evil plants. But when they're here, it's not their fault that they're here, by the way. We bring them over. But when they're here, they're actually doing evil things ecologically. They're depressing the diversity of our ecosystems to the point where many of them aren't functioning anymore. Rick Dark and I gave a talk at in Williamsburg two springs ago. And after the talk, we drove up, crossed the Bay Bridge up the eastern shore of Maryland on our way home, and we got to the Sunset Beach Inn and Grill. And there we go. There's all the calorie pears in full bloom, and this is why people plant them. Got a nice spring bloom, has a nice fall color, one of the cheapest trees you can get on the market. Now, they don't live very long, about 30 years, and you get that ice storm that brings them down, but it's obvious why they're so heavily used. Well, we kept driving right past the Sunset Beach Inn and Grill, and the very next piece of property looked like this. This is owned by a nature conservancy, I learned. I don't know how many acres it is, but it is thoroughly invaded with the offspring from these trees at the Sunset Beach Inn and Grill. So this is the horticultural landscape ethical dilemma of our times here. Almost everybody would argue the Sunset Beach Inn and Grill has the right to put any plant it wants on its property. But does it have the right to biologically pollute all the land around it? And of course, you people down here know you are in the heart of the cattle repair invasion. I can drive from New York to Richmond in the spring, and that's what I see. That's what I see all the way down. And none of those are planted, of course. So there are real consequences to our plant choices. You know, we talk about these guys having the right to put these plants on their property, but if that was smallpox, we would get it, that they really don't have the right to sprinkle smallpox around. They don't have the right to spill cyanide all over their property. We won't go there. Okay, which trees should we put in our landscapes? Now, we've been working on this for a number of years now, and this is the first thing we did. We made lists like this. This is a list of the woody plant genera in the mid-Atlantic states. And the numbers after each plant genus are the number of species of caterpillars recorded in the literature as using those plants as host plants. So memorize that. Well, what are we going to do with this list? It's ranked. The best ones are up here, and the ones that aren't doing so much are down here. Well, it turned out that this was a popular list. So I would go to Wisconsin, and they'd say, where's our list? People wanted to look at this part of the list and put the most powerful plants they could in their landscape when they're doing some type of restoration. You know, people in Florida, where's our list? Where's our list in California? So for years, I told them, well, it took my technician 2 years to make this list, 4,000 references. And if you support my technician, she will make you a list. Well, the Forest Service said, we will support your technician for 1 year, and we want a list for every state. As a matter of fact, we want a list for every county in every state. Can she do that? It's really hard for me to find money for my technician, so I said, of course she can do that. Turned out she couldn't do that. She got faster at doing it, but it took her a year and a half. And that information is going to be launched on kind of a sub-website of the National Wildlife Federation called Native Plant Finder. Here's the URL. It was going to be launched in January, but there have been a number of computer issues or website issues trying to get it to function. The idea is that you type in your zip code, and the ranked list for your county will come up. Apparently, it seems to be working now, and you can actually try it. If there are problems, and I'm sure they're going to be, they're going to continue to work on it and fix those problems. But it's now an opportunity to find out, wherever you are, what a localized list of the most powerful plants are. But in making these lists, we've stared at them all over the country and recognized a really, really important pattern. I don't know why it didn't jump at me before, that there are a few species or a few genera of plants that are producing most of the food. And most of the other genera are producing some food, but not very much. So I started calling those really powerful genera foraging hubs. And I started doing that because one day I was sitting on a Delta plane on the runway. We weren't going anywhere. So I was looking at the Delta magazine, and these are the Delta hubs that you can see in the back of the magazine. It struck me that illustrates exactly what I'm talking about here. Let's make them foraging hubs. Now, each line going into this oak tree here could be a bird, could be a species of bird, it could be a lizard, something going in to find food that oak tree has produced. It is a foraging hub. Same with the willow, the cherry, the pine up here. These other black dots are plants in your landscape as well, and the birds and the things are going to those plants to get food, but not very much, because they're not making very much food. Point is, if you took these big guys out of your landscape, you would have a failed food web, because all of these other species are not producing enough food, even if you combine it together. So it turns out that 5% of the local genera that you could put in your yard are producing between 73% and 75% of the food if we count caterpillars as the major source of food. And caterpillars are representing, well, what other insects are doing too. So 5% producing 73-75% of the food. Let's turn that on its head. That means 95% of the available genera that you could put in your yard. And we're just talking about natives here. 95% of them all combined would only produce 25-27% of the food. All I'm saying is you've got to include those foraging hubs, those core genera, in your landscape, or you're going to have a failed landscape. One that's producing only 25% of the food it could produce is not going to be considered a success, even though these are all native plants. The other thing we notice is that this pattern exists all over the place. These are the bioregions of North America. Each color is a different bioregion. And we've looked at this pattern in each of these bioregions. It's the same, 5% producing about 75% of the food. It doesn't matter whether it's in the north. It doesn't matter whether it's in the south. It doesn't matter whether it's in an area with a lot of plant species or just a few plant species. It's a really consistent pattern. So that's good. All you have to do then is figure out what the core genera, the foraging hubs for your area is, and then you've got it. Start with them, and then you can add all of the other species, some of the other species, to diversify that food web, but it will still hold together because of those core genera. So around here, as I said, oaks are certainly among the best. They are the best, so you can't leave them out. 557 species of caterpillars produced by oaks, or 557 species of bird food, if you want to look at it that way. Let's compare that to ginkgo biloba down here. Very common tree used in urban plantings. There are four species recorded in the literature as eating ginkgos, but they're all mistakes. How do you get a mistaken record in the literature? It's actually pretty easy. There are a lot of caterpillars. One of those records is the Cecropia moth. So the Cecropia moth, the monarch, black swallowtail, they're all doing the same thing. They eat until they reach the size at which they're going to make their cocoon or form their chrysalis, and then they crawl off the host plant. They'll walk for 25 minutes, 45 minutes, then they stop and make their cocoon wherever they are. There's a Cecropia cocoon on my back porch right now. It was not eating my back porch. It was eating the black cherry that's a little bit away. So I'll bet somebody found a Cecropia cocoon on a ginkgo. It had crawled up, spun its cocoon, and logically but incorrectly concluded, oh, it was eating the ginkgo, when in fact it wasn't. So if you ever see something eating a ginkgo, take a picture of it and send it to me. And I've been saying that for years now. I don't have any pictures yet. But even if those are good host records, 557 versus 4, which would you plant if you want to support life around you in your yard? Number two on the list, native prunus. So things like black cherry and pin cherry and American plum, Chickasaw plum. 456 species of caterpillars. Very powerful tree. Let's compare that to Zelkova, another really common street tree. Used, I guess, because it looks like the elms, a little bit like the elms that we lost to Dutch elm disease. Zero caterpillars on Zelkova. So if you want a plant as a street tree or in your yard that is not interacting with anything, that's always going to look perfect, I suggest you plant a plastic plant or a silk plant. You won't have to water it. It'll always be perfect. And you'll have a dead landscape, because that has to be the goal. If you're planting Zelkova, it's not going to interact with anything. Pieris japonica is probably the most common foundation plant that we have in North America, but we have native pieris. We have native pieris, but they only support two species of caterpillars. And this illustrates that not all natives are equal. And that's what that foraging hub thing, that core genera, is demonstrating. Some are really powerful, but they're orders of magnitude more powerful than most of the other native plants that we have. Tulip trees, for example, support 21 species, compared to oaks that support 557. We want tulips. We just don't want tulip monocultures. And many of our forests are tulip monocultures. So it's really not a native versus non-native argument. It's a productive plant versus non-productive plant. Make sure those productive plants are there, and then you can diversify with other plants. So your Pieris japonica could be a native viburnum that supports 103 species. These are the decisions we make every time we put a plant in the ground. So try to think of these plants as if they are bird feeders. There you go. Now, you get to decide how well you're going to feed the birds. You can feed them a lot, or you can be like the landscapes where I come from and feed them very little, giant lawns with just a few plants. You can put seed in those bird feeders. The birds aren't eating the feeders. They're eating the seed in that feeder. Or you can keep them empty. That's the ginkgo back there. It's a big tree, but it's not making any food. And when we landscape in ways that do not include these core genera, these foraging hubs, we're not fooling the birds at all. Here's some data from my PhD student, Desiree Naranjo, who's looking at the relationship between Carolina chickadee breeding success and the landscape in which they're breeding, right here in the suburbs of Washington, D.C. She does have study sites right here in Takoma Park. She's looking at 93 pairs of breeding chickadees. And this is what a typical breeding territory looks like. That's where the nest is. The red line represents that 50 meters from the nest where they're foraging. And these blue areas represent 95% of the foraging effort. These are the plants to which those birds are going to get food to feed their young. So let's look at what those species are. Well, they're all the native trees in this area. Basswood, sweet gum, American elm, black cherry, and two species of oaks. Now let's look at the plants they're not going to. Hard to read, but Japanese maple, silk tree, there's our friend the ginkgo, black poplar, crepe myrtles, saucer magnolia. It's very easy to picture a landscape where those are the dominant trees. We have most of the trees there as decorations, but not there to feed our chickadees. And when that happens, this happens. This is a failed nest. And after Desiree took the three dead chicks out of this nest, she noticed a bunch of sunflower seeds in the bottom of the nest. What she thinks happened is the parents ran out of caterpillars. Somebody had a bird feeder up. They tried to feed the babies sunflower seeds. Babies can't eat sunflower seeds, so they all starved to death. So that is the result of our landscaping choices. We are impacting other things in our neighborhoods. She's also looking at the migrants, the species of migrating birds that are flying right through D.C. and stopping to rest during their migration. 51 species so far have come down in the neighborhoods that Desiree is looking at. And when they come down, they do exactly what an oven bird that my wife ran into yesterday did. They have to rest and they have to refuel. This oven bird was so tired, it just sat there. You know, Cindy walked right up to it. Would have been a good photo op, but she didn't have a camera. There it is. No, somewhere around here. These birds are exhausted and they have to refuel. They have flown all night long. Sometimes they can fly up to 300 miles, and they're using all of their energy reserves to do that. They don't fly around our cities. They fly right through them, and they come down when they run out of gas, which is typically about 4 a.m. in the morning. If they don't get to refuel, that's the end of their migration. And if they come down in the land of ginkgo, they're not going to refuel because the tree's not making anything. So a lot of people say, I have a small property. I cannot support breeding birds because it's not a big enough piece of property, and that may be true. But if you have room for a single tree, the choice of that tree is going to dictate what happens to our migrating birds. And it probably has a lot to do with those very steep declines we're seeing in birds every year. We do the State of the Birds report. So you don't have to save biodiversity for a living, but I really do encourage you to think about saving it where you live. And again, the street tree choices you make are going to either make the birds around here or they're going to break the birds around here. They're critical. So we move plants all over the world, creating what ecologists call novel ecosystems. I think that term was coined by Richard Hobbs here. He's written a couple of books about it. But a novel ecosystem is simply one in which the organisms are just meeting each other for the first time in evolutionary history. Those are novel interactions. But that means they have not had the time to develop all those specialized interactions that I opened the talk with. So that means those specialized interactions are leaving our novel ecosystems. Our novel ecosystems have fewer species than our co-evolved ecosystems. So the question is, does that matter? How many species do we need, we as humans? Let's be selfish about it. We're pretty good at that. The answer is, we need all of them. We need all of the species that we can possibly get, because it is those species, it's the plants and animals in our ecosystems that are creating the ecosystem services, that are running the ecosystems, We should call them biodiversity services so people would understand why we need other living things. There was the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment back in 2005, where hundreds of scientists from around the world got together to measure the Earth's ability to support us by measuring the production of ecosystem services. Their unhappy conclusion is that, or was, as of 2005, we had already degraded 60% of the planet's ability to support us. That's the same thing as saying we have shrunken the planet by 60%. At the same time, we keep making more and more humans using more and more resources. A five-year-old can see that relationship is not going to last very long. This is the ocean, by the way. And this guy, it's not a recycling plant. This guy's going out to fish. I wish him luck. Well, why don't we let our natural areas make all the ecosystem services we need? That's what we have done in the past. We had very rich ecosystems. They produced what I will call ecological interest. We could use that interest, and they would always produce more because we weren't dipping into the principle. The ecological principle making that interest. But now we're doing that. We're pretty much everywhere. We've reduced the natural areas that are making all of that those ecosystem services to the point where we've used up the interest and we're well into the principle. There's only 5% of the U.S. that's relatively pristine these days. It's either us, it's our corn and soybeans, or it's our cattle all the way to the Pacific coast. We've turned the world into Gone with the Wind. Is this anybody's house around here? I did that once. It wasn't good. Because we have come to see plants just as decorations. We love these broad savanna-type landscapes. We feel very safe in them. We understand why we do this. But this landscape was not designed in a way that will support us. It was not designed. So we need to raise the bar about what we're asking our landscapes to do. In the past, we've asked them to be pretty. We're good at that. But they also have to support life. If we don't support life at home, where we work, where we play, and to a lesser extent in agriculture, we're going to lose it. And if we lose it, we'll have ecosystem collapse and we'll disappear. So not good. We need to sequester carbon. Enormous problems with the carbon in the atmosphere right now. But you know, a third of that carbon has come from the plants we've removed from the ground. We've cut down half of our forest. That is carbon that has vaporized and is up in the atmosphere. So we need to put the plants back that can pull that carbon out of the atmosphere, build their own tissues from it, but even more important, pump it into the ground. The Earth's soils can hold 7 times the amount of carbon that is now currently in the atmosphere. That's the solution to our carbon woes. Put it back in the soil. Who puts it in the soil? Our plants do. Our plants put it in the soil, so we've got to put our plants back where we've taken them away. We need to manage our watersheds right at home. Everybody lives in a watershed. Who gets to live there without properly managing that watershed? I can't think of anybody. We need to support our pollinators at home. There's not enough natural areas to do that. Why do we need pollinators? Everybody's going to tell me, because they pollinate our crops. And that's all you hear about on NPR or any place else. They pollinate a third of our crops. And yes, very handy things to have around. Oh, there's a pollinator, by the way. They pollinate 80% of all the plants that are out there and 90% of all the flowering plants. Forget our crops. If we lose our pollinators, we'll lose 80 to 90% of the plants on the planet. Not an option. Simply not an option. We are not talking about good land stewardship here. We are talking about essential land stewardship. And I am sure at the final presidential debate, I am going to hear about essential land stewardship. There's a family that lives in this house. If they're not making all of the ecosystem services they use on a daily basis, they're going to have to borrow them from someplace else. Now, they're not going to borrow them from their neighbor because he's not making any either. They're probably not going to borrow them from their township's open space. If it looks like my township's open space, which is a huge mowed lawn with a paved surface and people walk in circles around it. We think if there's not a building on a piece of land, it's good land stewardship. But this is not good land stewardship. Either is this. This is a house down the street from me. From a watershed perspective alone, we need to reduce the area that's in lawn. We've measured the amount of lawn in this part of the world. 92% of the area that could be landscaped is lawn. 92%. we only have 10% of the tree biomass in a typical suburban yard that we could have. And they're typically short-lived ornamental trees like calorie pear that are going to fall over in 30 years and release all the carbon they've just sequestered. We've got to get the big guys back. And you guys, looking at your street trees here in Takoma, are doing very well with that. But don't give up on the big trees. They're essential. And of course, the bigger the tree, the more it's pumping into the ground. And we can't do what my neighbor's done here if we want to have viable food webs at home. There's his 32 Bradford pears. As a matter of fact, he's got 10 acres, and every plant he's put on that 10 acres is an out-of-towner. It's a non-native plant not doing what it should be doing. And, That's because, again, we think plants are decorations because they are decorations. They're beautiful. When we go to the nursery, we look for something that's pretty. We get the same things all the neighbors have, so we don't stick out. And I understand that. But it's got to be pretty. Maybe it can be a screen, an anchor, a focal point. It's all been about aesthetics for at least 100 years without any consideration to the ecological role that these plants are playing. But we could do that. We could find pretty plants that do have food web value, that are protecting our watershed, sequestering carbon, helping the pollinators, doing all the things we need them to do at home. Wait till you take your picture there. Okay. So how do we do that? What's a biodiversity-friendly suburb look like? This is the most important thing we need to do. We've got those isolated habitat fragments. What's in between them? We are. In some form or shape, we are in between them. So we need to put the plants back that we've taken out of those areas. And if we do that, we can build biological corridors that reconnect those isolated habitat fragments. We can do that without moving out. We're simply going to put the plants back. If we reconnect them, those habitats aren't isolated anymore. And if they're not isolated anymore, when those populations fluctuate, well, if they're not isolated anymore, the populations won't be small. So when they fluctuate, they won't disappear anymore. This is the single most important thing we can do to stop the steady drain of species from our neighborhoods. Where are we going to put these plants? I suggest we put them in the area that's in lawn, because we've got so much lawn. 45.6 million acres was the last time it was measured, and that was several years ago. But now with all the ag people putting in lawn on the size of their fields, it's a lot more. Adding 500 square miles of lawn every year. 45.6 million acres, by the way, is more than 8 times the size of New Jersey, if you want a feeling for how much lawn that is. And why are we doing this? We're doing it because it's a status symbol. In the old days, only rich people could have lawns. You either had enough slaves or you had enough sheep. Either way, you were rich and you could have a very nice lawn. And then around the turn of the century, we invented the lawnmower, and all of us poor slobs could have lawn. So we raised the bar again. In the 50s, you had to have a perfect lawn or you were a communist. And today, if you watch the fertilizer commercials, it tells you very clearly, if you have a dandelion in your lawn, you're not a good person. And your neighbor will not like you. So you can fix that by buying the fertilizer. We can change our status symbols. I went to Montana a few years ago, and I looked around. They did not have big lawns. And I asked my host, where are your big lawns? And he said, we only get 9 inches of rain a year. But he said, lawn is not our status symbol. I said, really, what is? And he thought about it, and he said, big belt buckles. And I'm excited about this, because I think that's the answer. If we double the size of our belt buckles and cut the size of our lawn in half, we've got it. And then, of course, we want to build those corridors out of those powerful plants that we're talking about here. This is what we've done in the past. We build our house, put in our foundation planning, then put a tree here, there, and there. Then we're exhausted. No more landscaping. Everything by default becomes lawn. Let's turn that on its head. Let's build our house and now figure out where we do want turf grass. We're not going to get rid of lawn because it is the perfect plant to walk on without killing it. So we need to figure out where we're going to walk. I look at where my neighbors walk and their 10 acres of lawn. Nowhere. Never outside. But what if you want to get married in the front yard? What if you want to walk to the backyard? You need a grass path there. Or throw the frisbee, have a barbecue. Wherever you're going to use that yard, that's where the lawn goes. And then everything else by default becomes heavily planted. And this is the landscape design challenge of our times. How do we get all of these plants into our landscape and create a very different aesthetic than what we have now without it looking wild and messy? Do we have any landscape designers or architects here? okay, the ball is in your court. Figure out how to do that. If we convince our neighbors to do the same thing, then we've got the connectivity with the woodlot over here and the woodlot over here. Not only will you stop the drain of species from your neighborhood, you will reverse it. They will come. They will come. And I can guarantee that's what we've done at home. We have 10 acres at home. It was mowed for hay when we moved in. We now have 54 species of breeding birds because we put the plants back. There will still be lawn, so we can still play with our lawnmowers. It'll be okay. Now, if we do this in half the area that's in lawn, let's make the math simple. Say it's 40 million acres. Cut that in half. We can build a new national park that'll be 20 million acres in size. We're going to do it at home, so we'll call it Homegrown National Park. And it'll be bigger than the Adirondacks, plus Yellowstone, plus Yosemite, Grand Tetons, Canyonlands, Mount Rainier, North Cascades, Badlands National Park, Olympic National Park, Sequoia National Park, the Grand Canyon, Denali, which is huge, Great Smoky Mountains. You add up all those parks, still less than 20 million acres. So let's do that. Let's take areas that look like this. This is the Toledo Zoo. That's the entrance, that fine lawn with the dandelions there, and turn it into this. And believe it or not, when they did this, there was a huge outcry from the board that runs the Toledo Zoo because they said nobody will like it and they won't come to the zoo anymore. Let's take areas that look like this and turn them into this. So forget the native, non-native. We're simply putting plants back where we live. We haven't moved out here. We're sharing now. We're getting rid of the idea that humans are here and nature is someplace else. Now we're going to be together. This is a small little typical lot in the Rio Grande Valley of Texas. Right next door is somebody, the Texas Native Plants Society. Those are all native plants, same size lot, and it's a living landscape. Now here are those manicured lawns out there in Iowa that I was talking about next to the ag fields, but this also is in Iowa, and it's another option. And people are starting to do this. Let's take these square things. Let's put some plants in this landscape. This is a high-end landscape on Fisher's Island, where the Roosevelts live. I should have included more of the house there. But this landscape is doing everything I had on my little list there, except supporting the pollinators. So let's put in a pollinator garden, and then you've got everything. Now, this is a mulch sculpture, which proves you can't use native plants formally, except nobody told the folks in Indianapolis when they made a formal garden out of all native plants, which of course shows that's an urban legend. Formality is a function of the design, not a function of the plants in the design. Formal gardens in Europe use our native plants all the time, and it's okay because they're non-native plants over there. This is a corporate landscape, invites the employees to come out at noon to get sunburn. Could be a lovely setting like this, and there's really exciting research that shows if you spend just 15 minutes in an area like this, there are measurable medical benefits. Your blood pressure goes down, your stress hormone, your cortisol levels go down, your cancer is cured, you don't get divorced anymore. Why am I saying that? Because the research is showing you get the same benefits that you get from intense meditation, which has been shown to boost your immune system. You also, if you spend time in an area like this, you're recharging, you're restoring your attention span. Your attention span is eroded from the time you wake up in the morning till the time you come home at night and you're so on edge that you yell at your spouse. If you recharge it during the day, you're resetting the clock, you become a nice person again. But you can't go to Yellowstone for 2 weeks during the summer and expect that to last the rest of the year. The only way this is going to work is if you live in an area like this, or you work in an area like this, and you visit it on a regular basis. So I'm going to put another ball up here, call it mental health. We can call it physical health. If you put a plant outside of a hospital room, the patient gets better faster. If you put a plant outside of a classroom, test scores go up. And the connection seems to be with stress. When you lower stress, and for some reason being around plants and animals lowers our stress, we do everything better, including heal. You can also add three things to your yard, to your landscape, that may not be there right now. Surprise, anticipation, and entertainment. By surprise, I mean you can't walk into a landscape like this without seeing something you didn't expect to see, or at least I can't. Maybe if you look at your liatris flowers very closely, maybe you'll see the camouflage looper, which is busy snipping off these little petals and gluing it to his back so that you can't see him. Maybe you'll see the green Leuconycta, or maybe you won't see the green Leuconycta if it's sitting on some lichens. where it blends in very nicely. Maybe you see the puss caterpillar with his cute little top knot. How cute is that? Or the hag moth, how interesting is that? Or the evening primrose moth. Where are you going to see that? Inside an evening primrose flower. That's where it spends the day. Maybe you'll see this dead leaf, which is actually a caterpillar. That's the larval form of the showy emerald, beautiful moth. Maybe you'll see the fawn sphinx. This is one of my favorite. I think it's gorgeous. I consider this art in the garden. By the way, this is one of the species that eats ash. It will disappear if we lose our ashes. Or maybe you'll see the spingicampa caterpillar. I show this to adults, and they say, ooh, is it going to sting me? I show it to my three-year-old granddaughter, and she says, ooh, is it tickly? It is not going to sting you, and it is tickly. Anticipation. Throw away your calendar. You can figure out what's going on seasonally by what's happening in your yard. This is what we use at home. We know spring has come when the toads sing or when the woodcock displays in our yard at home. And we anticipate that. If I'm out on the road, I call up Cindy and I say, are the toads singing? Are the toads singing? No, 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 no. And then yes. And that's a wonderful day. Because it shows us nature is still happening. There's still life out there. There's hope. It's a message of hope, and we love it. We know that it's midsummer when the white-lined sphinx starts to pollinate the evening primrose, and it's fall when the juncos come. By the way, it's not fall yet. They haven't shown up, so keep your fingers crossed. Entertainment. This is a bottlebrush buckeye. I walked by two summers ago. 17 swallowtails flew up. You can't walk through a cloud of 17 swallowtails without a smile on your face. But does that mean your yard has to be 100% native? I get asked this all the time. And the answer is no, it doesn't. There's room for compromise here. Just understand what each of your plants are doing and what they're not doing. Don't assume they're doing something they're not doing. Let's consider crepe myrtle, for example. It is the quintessential decoration. You can get it in any color. It's not too tall. It's got exfoliating bark, and it's planted a lot. I know you use it a lot here in D.C. As we move further south, they use it more and more. By the time you get to South Carolina, it's now the only plant in the state. What is it contributing to food webs? Zero. Nothing. So, you know, what's attractive that's kind of biologically inert? I always think of statues. But how many statues? You know, one or two. One or two works. But how do you know when you've succeeded? When you have holes in your leaves. That is not the message to get the spray can. This shows this shingle oak leaf was doing its job. It passed on part of its energy to a caterpillar, which is now in the belly of a bird. It has created life in your yard. And if you have leaves on your plants that have no holes in them, they're not doing their job. That's a dead end for that energy. So this is a measure of success. When you have fireflies, lightning bugs, they're not flies or bugs. They are beetles. That's what the adult looks like, but the larva looks like a little dinosaur, and it lives in leaf litter. It lives in the duff on the ground if you have left it there, where it is feeding on other arthropods and worms. If you rake up all the leaves, if you neaten up and adopt that culture of sterility in your yard, you will get rid of your breeding population of lightning bugs. If you have Kemlon, that spreads poison on your lawn, you will get rid of your lightning bugs. If you have your security light blaring all night long, you will really make it a challenge for these guys to communicate with each other. So if your neighbor gets lightning bugs, you're doing something right. And of course, if you have breeding birds, you can't have breeding birds unless you have the food to support them. And you won't have the food to support them unless you have the plants that make that food. So this is a real measure of success. So we can save nature, but only if we learn to live with it. And I'm going to leave you with one example of how easy that actually can be. It's an example of the Atala butterfly, which was accidentally saved from extinction, global extinction, in the suburbs and the residential neighborhoods of South Florida. This is a lycaenid butterfly, which is it's beautiful as an adult. It's beautiful as a larva, beautiful as a chrysalis. And like the other things I talked about today, it is a host plant specialist, but in this case, an extreme specialist. It eats one species of plant. This is the kunti, a native cycad in South Florida. Well, kunti has an interesting history in that it has a lot of starch in its roots. The Seminole Native Americans knew that. They used it as a source of starch in their food. When the Europeans came to Florida, the Seminoles taught them, hey, there's a lot of starch in kunti roots. Well, around 1900, somebody had the idea of creating a starch industry, harvesting the Kunti roots. That's where the starch for our shirts came at the turn of the century. I think it was 1908 or 1912 census in Miami, 80% of the people that filled out the census identified their occupation as starch gatherers. And they did. They gathered all the starch. They eliminated Kunti from the wild. It is still gone from the wild. But there were some plants that survived in local gardens. Well, just a few plants in gardens was not enough to support the Atalas, so it disappeared. In 1973, we get the Endangered Species Act. There was a desperate attempt to find some Atalas so they could get it listed as an endangered species so that they could get some federal funding to help bring this butterfly back. But nobody could find any, so they got it officially listed as extinct. But about that time, the horticultural trade recognized Kunti as a valuable landscape plant. It is a low-growing evergreen shrub that does well in the sandy soils of South Florida, so they started promoting it. And today, there are lots of big Kunti plantings, both in parks and in residential neighborhoods. And look who showed up again. I used to say nobody knew where it came from, but so I met somebody who said, yeah, there was actually a little population on one of the keys, and they're pretty sure that's where it came from. It's out colonizing those residential Kunti plantings quite successfully. So what I love about this story is that it truly was a mistake. They never got the Atala listed as an endangered species. They never got any federal funding, not one dime of conservation funding, which is good because we don't have enough dimes of conservation funding. The only thing it did was change the palette of plants that those residential neighborhoods used by one. They added Kunti to the list of plants, and the butterfly saved itself, which shows this is a really powerful form of conservation. If we can save this butterfly from extinction by accident, think what we could do if we made conservation a conscious goal of residential landscaping. So I think it's going to work because nature has proven to be a lot more malleable, a lot more resilient, a lot more forgiving than we ever thought she would be, than I ever thought she would be. I can guarantee, though, she is not endlessly forgiving. There's going to be a point at which she does not bounce back. But I think she's going to give us one more chance. And remember what the Donald says, make America native again. Okay, we have 5 minutes. Uh-oh, somebody turned me off. Yeah. Back on. We got 5 minutes for questions, if anybody has any. Yes.
So I wanted you to talk a little bit about your work with native cultivars.
Okay. Cultivars at Mount Cuba. The question of whether cultivars of native species are as good as the straight species is one of the most common questions I get. Because when you go to the nursery, that's typically all you can find is a cultivar. So several people have started studies looking at that exact question. Now think about what creates a cultivar. There's really only a few types of genetic changes that do it. And most of them focus on flowers. Our study at Mount Cuba is looking at what happens to those caterpillars, the foliage feeders, the other things that are eating the plants themselves, when you either find a genetic variant in nature and propagate it, that's a cultivar, or when you actually breed for something, change the genome itself. And what we have found, we looked at a number of traits. We looked at what happens when you make a tall plant short, when you increase berry size, when you enhance fall color, when you introduce disease resistance, when you take a green leaf and you make it purple, or you make it variegated. These are all the types of things that we looked at. And the most powerful effect, negative effect, is when you take a green leaf and you make it red or purple, because you're loading that leaf with anthocyanins, which are feeding deterrents. So that is that's the biggest negative effect we found. We found that if you take a tall plant and you make it short or you do those other changes that I just mentioned, it's not affecting the things that eat the leaves in a measurable way. Now, the people that have looked at flower changes, Annie White up at in Vermont just finished her PhD looking at what happens with flowers. We have some students at the University of Delaware working on this. Apparently, the flowers are much more sensitive, or the response of pollinators is much more sensitive when you change a particular flower. Flowers have very tight energy budgets. So if you take an echinacea and you make the flower, the petals, twice as big, you're messing with that energy budget and probably reducing the amount of nectar that's available to the pollinators. They're just starting to measure what's happening to the pollen itself. Pollen is very complex. It's loaded with protein and a number of amino acids. It also can have secondary metabolic compounds, those same defenses that I talked about. So they're trying to keep pollen robbers away and only the bees that are adapted to that particular plant. And when you start fooling with all of that, apparently you are messing with the pollinators quite a bit. So that's what Annie White found, that most of the time it decreases flower visitation rates. What I don't like about cultivars is that to propagate them, we almost always do it clonally. So what we're doing is creating a plant with zero genetic variability and then planting it out in the wild. And we know that's not a good idea. Genetic variation is a good thing, and you eliminate it with cultivars. The other thing I don't like is that it perpetuates the idea that plants are just decorations. We don't need to do that. It suggests plants that you have to raise or lower the hemline of plants every year by creating a new cultivar, or the public won't buy them. So I would like to see straight species sold right alongside of the cultivar until the nursery industry recognizes there is a market for those straight species. Give you a choice. You should be able to buy them when you go to the nursery. Yes? Oh, I see.
They're not getting wild.
Yeah. Right. So even if they're not cloning them, they're reproducing from the same stock over and over again, which limits the amount of genetic variability. Good point. I hadn't thought about that. Yeah. The real answer is we don't know, because so many of the host records say eats oaks. And I do have an experiment in the refrige at this point where we looked at 15 species of oaks and collected the caterpillars in a standardized way so that we could actually compare those 15 species. I think there is a slight edge in the white oak group where they're making slightly more than the red oak group. But by and large, I'm going to say it doesn't matter because first of all, oaks hybridize a lot, which tells you that they're really closely related. And their basic chemistry defense is tannins. If you're adapted to tannins of one oak, you can almost certainly handle the tannins of another oak. So my guess is most of the oaks are supporting the very similar fauna.
How much is it okay to clean up in the fall? An 8-foot tall ironweed that I would like to cut down to dry.
Right. This is the perpetual problem. First of all, your ironweed is loaded with seeds at the top. And we didn't talk about what those seeds are doing for overwintering birds, but the goldfinches and the sparrows will hang from those things and eat those seeds all winter long. It is a source of seeds. And you could say, I put out bird seed, but not all birds go to these feeders, particularly our sparrows. So our black-eyed Susans and our New York ironweed and all those things, evening primrose, those are providing seeds for wintering birds. And when we cut them down in the fall, you have eliminated all of those seeds. So one option might be to, if they're in your front yard, and you know, I get that, cut them down and maybe tie them together like one of those cornstalk displays and stand them up someplace where the birds can still get at those seeds. There's also another thing. In the pith of those stems, that's where a lot of our native bees nest and spend the winter. So if you cut them down and compost them, you've lost all those nesting sites. So there are good biological reasons to not do that, but I understand that dead stalks don't look nice. So one thing you might want to do is that's where you can be sensitive about what you're having in your front yard versus your backyard. Picture what it's going to look like in the wintertime and put those things in the backyard. Yes?
Dr. Tallamy, on behalf of the Carolina chickadees that your student Desiree
We'll thank Desiree. Yeah, she just had a baby, by the way.
Oh, congratulations to her. You talked about food for birds, but this community is one of only three communities in the whole state of Maryland certified as community wildlife habitats by the National Wildlife Foundation.
Okay. Congratulations.
And the other elements of that is, you no doubt know, are water, cover, and places to raise young, sustainable practices. On the subjects of cover and places to raise young, prowling domestic cats in our neighborhood.
Yeah.
Last week I found a dead ruby crown kinglet in my yard. Today I found a collar of a cat from a house that I've asked to keep in their house. What are we going to do, folks? I mean, really, the National Wildlife Federation might not approve of this practice that we have of allowing cats to prowl on birds in our neighborhood.
You know Pete Mara?
Yes, here's his book.
He lives here in Takoma. Yeah. The birds are killing 2 to 3 billion birds. The cats are killing 2 to 3 billion birds a year. And billion, let me remind you, 1 billion is 1,000 million. It is a lot of birds. As a matter of fact, it's almost a third of the entire North American bird population. Serious impact. Pete talks about it and he gets death threats. So there are people that love their cats. There's got to be a compromise because it's having a tremendous hit. And that's the end of questions.